March 22nd, 2006, in Flemington.
Go ahead.
My father was always known as Wald, W-A-L-D. But he was born and raised up through college as Peterson.
Oh, wow.
But my mother thought Peterson was just a common everyday name, like Smith or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. And so she said, why don't you just take the word Wald? That's unusual. And she didn't realize, actually, that it was pretty Jewish.
Is it, really?
Oh, the Wald is a very Jewish name.
Really? I didn't know.
All the Walds I've known, other in Hollywood and so forth, were all of people in that were Jewish.
Oh, yeah.
And but that's where that came from. And
just by choice.
Well.
So our heritage should have been Pedersen.
Oh yeah.
And not. You know how they take the first name and put son after it, not Waldson.
No.
They stopped doing that by then, I guess.
Huh? No. We went down to Wildwood every year for years, and then after my freshman year of college, we stayed down there for the whole summer.
Mm-hmm.
And because she said I was worn out. I said I looked haggard and I need to be rejuvenated. So, well, I never worked so hard in my life as I did the first year at MIT. I was scared. I was running scared. And so I worked like a dog, and she saw that, and so she decided to. We ran his little house on the beach down in Wildwood, and I spent the whole summer down there.
Yeah. She must have been an amazing woman, huh?
I went through two or three girlfriends that summer.
Oh.
it was a great summer.
Yeah.
I always say how privileged I was.
Yeah.
I mean, most of my friends, you know, they had to, they didn't go on that kind of vacation, you know, and then we went down there for a whole country. My father came down every weekend. And my classmates at college, they came down three or four times during the summer. And we lived next door to a Catholic retreat for priests. And my mother got to know all of them. And because she gave them such a hard time, she said, don't you know you're keeping some woman from being happy? She really ran the daylights out of me. And they loved us. But she really meant it, so I don't think they realized that she was serious.
Yeah.
But that was a great summer.
Yeah. You remember that? And it was 38, I think, yeah.
Oh, when Sylvie got married?
Yeah.
Oh, I remember movies of that.
Yeah, I've seen, you know, when our house burned down, we had movies, and then it got damaged in the fire. And so all we have is kind of, we tried to get it restored, but couldn't. It looked like a big affair to me.
It was a big affair.
Yeah.
Did you ever see movies of it?
Yeah. Yeah.
The people standing across the highway looking at it?
I haven't seen that. Yeah.
It was a big event. I do remember Sylvie because it was on the lawn. And I know one reason I remember is that I had to work for 2 days going up the mountain, cutting down branches and dragging them down with a horse. With a rope around the horn. Dragging down there so my dad could build this bower.
Oh, we did.
He built a wood platform, and they built a whole back over the bower, and they were married in front of that. It was quite a layout.
Oh, we did.
everybody. Let's rock.
About 7:25 in the evening, July 15th, 2007. Anyway, here we are again. This is Christine Gravely. This is Mormor's mother. And she died in 1918. Anyway, Christine was married to Gilbert Goldbranson. He died. She married Wegger Gravely. I'm going to got to verify this. And then after Christine died, Wegger married Elsa Christine Gravely, and Ronnie Gravely Coons was their daughter. And I see there's a recent addition since we've been here last time. Kari Holta Gravely died in 2004. Okay, we're looking from across the river. I see the rear of the house has a round porch, like in the photos that we have seen. And my guess is that that's Ronnie's house. We'll drive over there in a minute. The rear of the Gravely house. Yeah. This is Ronnie and Eileen.
Have you always lived here?
Yes, I was born here.
Oh, wow.
In the house.
Your parents lived in this house?
Yeah. So that is...
Well, we stopped at the restaurant over there, and Elsa, she was real helpful, and I said, do you have a phone book? She said...
They're coming from... Yeah. Further up.
Oh, we saw so many waterfalls.
Yeah. The waterfalls must have been beautiful.
Oh, they were.
Because awesome. They have never been so full and sprudling.
Yeah. Very nice.
They were just so I could have done something.
Yeah, according to the guidebook on Farson, the town burned down about the early 1900s, and most all of the buildings are new since then. August 8th, 2004. Well, it's a beautiful place.
See across.
We've been looking all over for it, and Eileen's the one who found it. Wald Peterson. Looks like born January 21st, 1866, died November 2nd, 1918. Okay, that's the church. Now, we just called and talked to JJ, and that's Wald Peterson's grave right there. Now, we understand that he moved to Chicago, and my grandfather, Dad Ed, was born in Chicago. My grandmother was born in Albert Lea, Minnesota. And I think even my grandmother's parents, I think, were born in America. I'm going to have to rehash that with JJ.
There's a view from up on the hill. View of fjord in Farsen down there. I think that's probably there.
Where we get the ferry? That's Sonja Ford, is it? Fjord?
I think so.
We have a webcam here. He says we can come back and look at this anytime. And here's the website.
Do you mind opening the car for just a second?
Feel the mist coming off the waterfall. Varing Falls? Is that how you say it?
I guess. Something like that.
Varing Falls?
Near a fjord in the town of Fossley, at the Fossley Hotel up there.
That's the guy who ski jumped, that old guy. Yeah.
So Eric wanted me to take this picture because he has his grandmother on film at pretty much the same spot. Probably in the 50s, something like that. And this is still the Bergen Fish Market, which of course has gotten more and more stuff around it other than fish these days.
I think he's getting reindeer sausage.
got a small one because there were only two available.
Two available.
And for some reason, I don't know why this one was available, but the other one was, I think, down below or something.
No upgrades available. Here we're coming into the Lofoten Islands. It is midnight. July 16, 2006.
There's
looks
something
like they're renovating.
We're moving out.
There's the lawn where my parents got married. It's changed quite a bit, hasn't it? There's Kruger's house, the caretaker's house.
That's
try to stop, that's the way it was built. It is July 26, 2008. We are at Solvang, a reception JJ's having at the shed for the family.
Hi, nice to see you.
Where did you go to college?
MIT.
Did you really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, over there.
I know, I went there, I graduated.
I think I asked you before about where the house was in Nitro. Okay, and then
it was on Area R. It was the main drag that went through town and had the only paved sidewalks in the whole town of Nitro. And you know why it was named Nitro?
Yeah, because of nitroglycerin.
Yeah. And the main drag was where the officers lived.
Yeah.
And they had cement sidewalks. And then where the enlisted men, they were wooden walks. Wooden sidewalks. Did everybody see a wooden sidewalk?
Yeah.
There weren't too many of them.
Yeah.
Well, it's a main street through. The high school's here, and then you walk across the street and down that first row of houses, and that was where the officers lived during the war. And that was called Area R. The street was Area R.
Okay, but then you don't know the street number of the house or anything, do you?
Well, I always find it could cross the street from where my house was raised, went up a hill. It's the only place you could do that. And so I can always find it from that.
Uh-huh.
And then behind the house was a creek I ran through. And so I can always find that from the swimming pool was a steel swimming pool.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't concrete. And that was a part of the manufacturing plants in that area. And they had the swimming pool for recreation for people. You know why it was named Nitro?
Because of the nitroglycerin?
We used to say it was because they built a row of houses every night.
Oh. Night row.
That's right. We saw Rolf in Japan.
Yeah.
Because I was at Okinawa.
Yeah.
And for the whole campaign. And I was sent to an occupation force into Japan, and I met my brother Rolf there.
Uh-huh.
And he had been in New Guinea. Uh-huh.
Ditt hoved manglar en cowboyhatt. Det ligger der og drømmer hver eneste natt om livet i brennende prærjesol. Et liv der du ikke trenger hjem til jul. Du rir slik en cruiser i Cadillac med mysende øyne og kroppen slakk. Og kommer der en slange, så sier du halt, så skyter hun deg med en sylblanke kalt. I en drøm i en natt. Og månen skiner, og kaffen fin og svart. Den natt, under en hatt, en rett ut sagt jæs. Klart jeg for cowboy og boyhatt. En cowboy og boyhatt. Ditt liv det mening for uten mål. Du hopper av hesten og gir opp et bål. Du har ingen evalueringstrang når solen gjeng ned bak en svart mustang. Og så kjem du fram til en by i sør, der trolig Clint Eastwood har vært før. Der sjelen blir kvesta og kroppen sett fri, men for deg gjør det lite at det slik det blir. I en drøm i en natt. Og månen skiner og kaffen fin og svart. Den natt, under en hatt, en rett ut sagt jæs. Glatt er for cowboy og boyhatt. En cowboy og boyhatt. Og full der du støtt, for moralen ikke fødsel. Alt du tenker om alt det som blenker, det slik den fær. Alt du trenger litt begjær og et jentefang. En blank mustang tek deg snart ut på farten. Og hesten, ja hesten heter Svarten. hva gjør du? Og der ligger hun som spør høyt til kloden Hva du drømte nå? Du svarer du har haft deg en opplevingstur Bort dit som kobayar og indianer bor I en drøm I en natt Og månen skin og kaffen fin og svart Den natt under en hatt En rett ut sagt Jeg skal tøffe cowboy, cowboy Jeg skal tøffe cowboy En drøm I en natt Og månen skin og kaffen fin og svart Den natt under en hatt En rett ut sagt